It's been so long since last we met.
Lie down, forever lie down. Or have you any money to bet? Lie down, forever lie down. There goes old Georgetown, straight for a touchdown. See how they gain ground. Lie down, forever lie down. Lie down, lie down, forever lie down.
Madame Gandhi, it's been so long since last we met. It's great to see you.
I'm still Julia, it's such a pleasure. Thank you.
It's great to be with you today as a part of our special session of our 1789 Seconds for this year's 2021 Women's Forum. So thank you for joining us.
It's an honor.
So you have had quite the journey since you left our hilltop almost 10 years ago. You've toured drumming for M.I.A., Thievery Corporation, and most recently Oprah on her 2020 Vision Stadium Tour with morning dance party Daybreaker. You've been selected as Forbes Music 30 Under 30 and a 2020 TED Fellow. You've been critically acclaimed by the New York Times, Billboard, NPR, and somehow you managed to get your MBA at Harvard all during this time, right before your 10th reunion. It's just amazing. So I've listened to your TED Talks. I'm playing the music around the house. I've read all your articles. Yeah. And I wanted to share with you that I feel radically uncool to be interviewing you today, but I'm going to muster whatever I can and jump right in.
Well, I love that you're wearing yellow, and I love this academic background, and I miss my academic environment, so I'm just so happy to hold space with you.
That's fantastic. I am as well. I am on the corner of 36 and O as we speak, so I am in the heart of Georgetown. So let's start here at the Hilltop. You were a math major, and I have to say my daughter, who graduated in 2019, was a mathematics major here as well. So we have that bonding us together. And you're a women's studies minor. I love how you perfectly managed to bring together your passion and your purpose, your art form and your academics. Tell me about your time at Georgetown and your journey with music and math.
I remember coming in, you know, because Georgetown has such a strict curriculum requirement. And so I remember coming in with a bunch of AP credits in math, and I was good at it. So I was like, I'm going to do a math major. And I also appreciated that the math department was actually such a cozy, small department in the context of a university that is often so focused on international relations and, of course, the SFS and things like that. And so I found enormous community in the math department. I found enormous mentorship and support, and I appreciated late nights, you know, working on problem sets with my other peers. You know, I really appreciated the kind of nerdy punk rock spirit of the math department, because you're good at this like really specific skill set, and yet you're kind of like ostracized from the rest of campus. I remember, I'll never forget, I got a 99 on the final of my multivariable calculus class my freshman fall. I got a 99, and I'll never forget that. That's when I knew I had to commit to the math major. So it was certainly the right choice. I'm still in touch with Professor Eller. I'm still in touch with a person who is out of the math department as well, called Michael Somos. And so my intuition around community for the math department was absolutely correct.
And then somehow during this time, you brought math and music together.
It was a must. In my final year at Georgetown, there was an opportunity to do an independent study. And so I looked at how you can actually use the tuning of a drum to get the most optimal sound as a method of explaining Bessel functions and explaining waves in two dimensions. And I really appreciated how supported the independent coursework was. And it ended up being a really pivotal experience for me to be able to know that math can be applied to music. And then, of course, to go on and produce music. It's a very mathy experience when you're on your laptop producing beats and producing sounds. The math major helped me more than I could have imagined.
That's very cool. Before we leave our hilltop here, tell me, did you have a favorite memory, a favorite moment, or is there some experience you had that set you on your path and has stayed with you?
There are so many memories. I think my favorite memories were any time that I performed in Gaston Hall. I was always performing, whether it was dancing with the South Asian Student Association for Rangila, whether it was drumming with the Young Women's Drumming Empowerment Project, whether it was sitting in with the Afro-Cuban Percussion Ensemble, whether it was giving a speech because I ran for GUSA every year and really enjoyed being on the Student Association. My favorite memories were performing in Gaston Hall.
That's fantastic. I didn't realize that. That's really, truly wonderful. Okay, we're going to change gears a little bit. I'm really curious to find out how you were getting your MBA at Harvard and also on tour with MIA, and also the fact that I read or heard that your parents didn't know that you were flying around the globe while you were in between case studies at Harvard.
You know, that's so funny that you bring that up, because it is true. And it was kind of one of those things where I feel like I had it under control. You know, when a kid is like, I got this, guys, like, don't mess with me, like, I got this. And so I felt like the more people I told, they would project their own fear and insecurities, that it would get messed up. And I didn't want to take that on. And I honestly still think I use that to this day. Like, if there's anything that I am a bit like, okay, this is a risk. But I know that my tolerance for risk is very high, and I'm very interested in high risk, high reward behavior, because it's always in the end benefited me, because if the risk fails, I still had an experience from it. And if the risk wins, then I'm moving forward in my life as a human. You know, I'm living to the fullest of my potential. And so it's true. I didn't tell my parents because I didn't want them to project their own fears that I might get kicked out of Harvard, which of course would have been a disaster. I just felt like that wasn't going to happen. I was like, I got this. The reason why that happened is that right out of Georgetown, I worked for 2 years at an incredible record label called Interscope Records, which is home to Lady Gaga and Maroon 5 and Eminem and all these incredible artists. And I used my math degree to get my first job as a data analyst studying patterns in Spotify streams at Interscope. And I got that through GEMA, you know, the organization at Georgetown that connects us to the music industry. So it was really like, thank you to my Hoya background for that opportunity. So I did that for 2 years. It was amazing. It was amazing. And it was a Georgetown alum who gave me that internship that turned into this prestigious job. I did that for 2 years, and it was MIA. Sorry.
Georgetown alum.
Justin Dreyfus.
Ah, super cool. Okay, thanks.
Yeah. So he gave me that job. So I worked there for 2 years. And I remember when MIA was signed to the label, I remember thinking, man, of all the people who are signed to this label, the one person I would just dream to drum for is MIA. I love her music. I love her radical spirit. I love the message in the music. I love all of it. And of course, I mean, it doesn't hurt that she's South Asian. I'm South Asian. There were so many connections. And I remember just pitching the idea. I was like, I could drum for you. You know, that was pretty much how it went. At the same time, I was applying to get my MBA because I really did believe that I wanted to be a leader in the music industry and sign bands who, you know, were pushing the needle forward on social justice and feminism and things like that. And I just was so aware of the enormous amount of misogyny in the music industry. And so I really thought if I had a more senior position on the business side, I could create great change. So I got into Harvard. I was getting ready to move out to do my MBA. And MIA's team, in good faith, got back to me and said, yeah, we have this tour that's happening in the fall of 2013, and we'd love to have you and come drum for us. And I honestly couldn't believe it. It was like such an incredible moment and opportunity. And so I did it. And I would go on the weekend to Poland and play 2 shows, and we'd fly, and I'd fly back and make it in time for class on Monday. And then the next weekend I'd play Japan. And then the next weekend after that, I would play, the UK. And there was one week where she was playing in Brooklyn Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. And so I would go to class in the morning in Boston and then fly to New York and play the show Monday night and then fly back to Boston Tuesday morning and attend school and then fly back Tuesday night to New York, play the show and fly back Wednesday morning. And you know what? I passed business school. I graduated. I got the tour done. I served, like, I was there present in both spaces. And it was probably one of the most exhilarating times in my life because I was balancing these two sides that are so dear to me.
2 questions from that. First of all, did your parents know during this time that you were doing this?
They definitely didn't know. And I definitely told them after the fact when it was already a success story.
Smart. That's so smart. And do you still live in this high risk, high reward mindset?
Very much so. You know what it is? A lot of times when I get opportunities that I know I'm not necessarily qualified for, I do always say yes, because I do think there's a hustle in having to learn something really quick. The other day I got asked to score a commercial, and I have some experience scoring, but usually it's in collaboration with somebody else. And I really welcomed the opportunity to have to make a song from scratch, write the lyrics, produce the track, send it to them, you know, write it to picture, and see how that felt. And in the end, they did choose another song. And so that's an example of when the high risk, high reward goes to somebody else. But I got paid for the work that I did up until that point, and I'm so grateful for the song that came out of it, because now I'm going to run with that song and make it with Sony anyway. And I had the positive experience of having to produce something really, really quick in a high intensity, you know, short week. And I'm grateful for that opportunity. So that's a small recent example. But yes, you got to go big or go home. When you're surfing, I'm living a California life. when you're surfing, they tell you, like, when the wave's coming, you can't hesitate. Like, you got to just say, I'm surfing this wave. It's happening. Yeah.
Or you're going to miss the wave.
That's so it.
You, your music and you, and I can tell, have been described as a force of nature, and I feel that. Tell me about your music. How would you describe it?
My music is positive. It's uplifting. It's intelligent. It's very full of love. Like, I want someone to listen to my music and feel like they're getting, like, the warmest, most, like, maternal, loving hug ever, you know, like a best friend who's encouraging you and soothing you and validating you and making you feel, you know, your worries and insecurities, that let them just melt away. Like, you're good. Like, you're doing your best. I love you. You know, that's how I want people to feel when they listen to my music. And I try to write lyrics that mimic the kinds of ways that I speak to my friends and my community and my team, which is with adoration and love and enthusiasm. And that is my feminism. I believe that's a feminine spirit, one of unconditional love, unconditional kindness, not a quid pro quo exchange, you know? In fact, it's quite the opposite. It's like, the more you try to punch me and beat me up, the more I just hug you more, because that's actually where that pain is coming from, you know? And my music is, I love making sounds that are like edgy or glitchy or, you know, a little bit distorted to round out the softness of the light female vocals and the kindness in the female vocals, so that it doesn't ever feel cheesy. It feels like it's cool to be kind. That's kind of the vibe. And then, of course, all my drums, you know, all the percussion, all the big, heavy programmed 808s. That's certainly what I learned during my time with MIA. And you know, I only have two bodies of work out. I'm working on, you know, my next body of work. And it does feel like a big jump up. I'm excited to put it out.
Yeah, and you're using music, and I'll get there for your message. But an aside quickly, I saw your video with the song Bad Habits, is that it? In the yellow Jeep, which is incredibly cool, and then you're out in the desert. And I love the different generations of women, different faces, different colors, different feel, all the way down to a child in the face of a young girl in it. That your message is resonating with every generation of women. It was fun too. It was great. And I like
it. Can I actually tell you one thing about that? Like, I wanted to make sure that we have all different gender identities represented and different age groups especially represented. And I really appreciate you picking up on that, because it was an intentional choice. And moreover, I wanted to choose people who are my actual friends. Like, that's the daughter of someone who's my actual friend. That's the mother of somebody who's my actual friend. We have folks who are, a couple folks in that video who are gender nonconforming or trans identifying. They're my actual friends. And so I wanted the vibe on camera to mimic the richness of my community, the richness of the people who I learn from every day, whether it's kids, because I learn from kids all the time, or our elders. And of course, my women's studies degree, one of the first things that we would look at is how our society problematically ages women specifically out, while men get to age and the sex, the older they are, the sexier they are, whatever that construct is, you know. And I really reject that, and I really find that so problematic. And in fact, some of the people who I have crushes on are always the elder women. I'm like, damn, like, I think I have a little crush on you. Like, you know, you're so wise and, like, on it and, like, such a boss, you know, like, and so I really wanted to celebrate that. And the fact that you noticed that means a lot to me. So thank you.
Every face was incredibly beautiful and also very different. Okay. So you have this concept of atomic living. And I think I get it. Tell me about it and how it's guiding your life.
Atomic living is really from my time at Georgetown, and I say this with all the love in my heart, but not even at Georgetown, like a lot of prestigious spaces, with a genuine intention to help our kids talk about, like, a 10-year plan and a 15-year plan and a 20-year plan. And I would always go into those meetings and feel completely debilitated, because I was like, I don't even know what I'm doing tomorrow. Like, I don't even know what classes I'm taking next semester. Like, how can you ask me about my 10-year plan? And I would always feel bad about that. But the more I've lived, the more I've learned that being present in the moment and saying, actually, what would excite me right now is taking this class on queer studies. And I feel like, actually, I would love to be a math major. And I couldn't tell you why. I just know that I want to be a math major. I think it's cool. I like the people, you know, like the reasoning. It's almost like the reason doesn't even make sense. Someone would be like, but you want to work in politics, or you might want to be an activist, or you might want to be a musician. Why would you be a math major? Like, it does, things certain don't make sense in the moment. But if there's this sense of joy, enthusiasm, excitement, and being present, every decision that I've made from that space has always served me throughout the entirety of my life in a way that I could have never imagined. And so sometimes most of the time when we have a 10-year plan, if you asked Kiran of, you know, I'm 32 now, if you asked Kiran of 22, what's your 10-year plan? There's no way she would think, go get your MBA from Harvard while drumming all over the world. She wouldn't think she's good enough. There's no way she would think she could run a marathon. She could barely keep up on the squash team. There's no way she would think that she would free bleed while running a marathon and open up this whole conversation about menstruation, because she was intimidated and scared. She was bullied as a kid. Like, there's no way that I would have had any of those beliefs in myself. And so that is why I really believe in this notion of atomic living, which is choosing things in the moment and making decisions based on happiness at that point, instead of a projected future hypothetical situation.
Yeah, I love that. It's a little bit contrary to everything we're taught about manifesting your life and thinking of where you want to end up in 5, 10, 25 years, as you say, imagine yourself and then create that life to get there. This is actually a little bit opposite than that, and saying, where is my joy right now and where is that leading me? I've been reading this book called The Great Work of Your Life, and it's all about identifying your dharma through the Bhagavad Gita. And it case studies different people in history and how they arrived at their dharma. And what I thought was really interesting is, in your lifetime, you can have more than one. You're not just born with one purpose for yourself throughout your life. It can change.
Wow.
And I was thinking that your atomic living idea helps you stay true to your own dharma. Would you agree with that?
Yes, that's such a validating way to explain it, because I do feel I have different passions and joys at different moments. And when I was a kid, my dad used to always yell at me, and he'd be like, you're a jack of all trades and a master of none. You know, he'd put me down for that. And I would always internalize that and believe that. And the more I step into the fact that different things give me joy at different moments, the happier my life has felt, and the more joy I have to then spread and do my message and give energy to other people. So I appreciate you saying that. I also really welcome the nuance and the challenge of the manifestation point that you made, because that is true. Of course, staying present may seem that it's the counterintuitive of that. Mm-hmm. I think I actually really enjoy manifestation power. I do enjoy doing my meditation every morning and visualizing my day and visualizing things I want to invite into my life. Mm-hmm. So I guess I have to figure out a way to incorporate that, because I do believe in manifestation, very much so. I think what I don't believe in is when someone's like, well, if you want to be rich in 20 years, you have to reverse engineer all of these steps. You know, this kind of thing that is like less from a spiritual place and more from like a capitalistic robot place.
Yes, I see what you're saying. But when you do focus on and give time to the idea of where you might want to be, it is very cool to see the synchronicities of life show up,
yes,
isn't it?
Yes, 100%, 100%. And in fact, sometimes when I get derailed from my journey, that's what I come back to. I have to just be like, Kiran, what do you want? Like, drop in, you know, take time, slow down. So I really, really appreciate you bringing that up. That's really beautiful, Julie.
So you have your art and your activism and your performance all comes together. And at the end, what your mission or goal or dharma is to elevate the female voice. And you do that through your art, through your activism, through your performance. And that feels right for you right now. Yes. Yeah.
Of course. Yeah. I think that what's interesting has been in stepping into my activist power, you know, after the marathon story, free bleeding went viral 6 years ago now at this point. And my own thoughts on feminism, the things that I learned in my women's studies class, my own intuition about the injustices that I see, not only in the music industry, but beyond, the way that we scrutinize and constantly stigmatize women and femmes in our bodies. That's really where the sort of journey of my more public work began, because I was always having these conversations privately with my friends and feeling really stimulated and present in those conversations. So it felt really empowering to do it in a more official and formal way as a career path, and also to incorporate it into my music. One of the most beautiful and challenging things of stepping into like a more activist role is the constant like feedback and pushback that I get in my own journey. But the beautiful thing is that we have to check our own ego. If someone pushes back on me, that's because something that I've said has made them feel excluded or isolated from my message. And so I'm constantly thinking about what are the vocabulary and what are the words that I can use to show up for folks of all gender identities, of oppressed gender identities, whether it's someone who identifies as trans or as gender nonconforming or as queer or as a member of the LGBTQIA+ community. How do I show up for women and femmes and feminine energy while still being inclusive to folks who feel like they place differently on the spectrum? And so that's been the constant work that I'm doing, maybe using words that suggest feminine power instead of female power, you know, being inclusive of folks who identify in all types of different ways, and actually saying that is the power in us being brave enough to step into our own authentic gender identity. That's the thing that liberates all of us. So it's been really beautiful and humbling to make sure I'm constantly having that feedback with my own social media, with my own community, and reading what other folks who are thinking about these issues are putting out.
It takes a great deal of awareness to be able to do that. I commend
you
for
saying that. Thank you for saying that.
In 2011, we started our alumni programming here at Georgetown. We had done work through our law center before then, but it's really across campuses is when we jumped into it. And now we're here a bit full circle at our third pan-campus women's forum, which is very, very cool again. But it was really interesting because the minute we launched it, we saw this huge hunger in our alumni community for this kind of community to come together to celebrate one another, to bond with one another, to empower one another, and to learn and share our stories. I mean, our women's forum and our other programming just took off, which was really amazing. And it made me think about the way you talk about femininity as an archetype in leadership. And you talk about collaboration over competition and emotional intelligence over brute aggression. And I also love the idea, and I want you to talk a little bit about it. And I think that you were inspired by Gloria Steinem, who talked about being linked, not ranked. If we keep doing what we're doing, how do you envision our world changing if we continue on this path?
See, every time I was young, or even when I went to business school, I watched traditional constructions of masculine leadership be affirmed and aspired to. It would constantly be like, speak up, speak louder, or even in the MBA program, it was oftentimes the loudest and more aggressive voices in the room that are taken more seriously. And I find that to be enormously problematic, because that leaves me with a choice, which is either to not speak at all or to perform a behavior that's not authentic to my identity and my leadership style. And I don't like that. In fact, it deprives all of us of the rich diversity of ways of thinking and presenting information that can actually lead us to a better and more nuanced outcome. When I watched 45 in the White House these past 4 years, it was constant. It's just so much aggression in the airwaves. Look at the way people feel anxious in their homes now. Look at the top-down leadership. It's so violent and aggressive in the way that that he's speaking. And yet that's seen by so many people as power. And I find that to be so problematic. And so that's why in my work, I love the idea of qualities such as collaboration, emotional intelligence, peacekeeping, kindness, self-awareness, awareness of others, all of these different behaviors as parts of a leadership style that we should all be aspiring to, no matter what your gender identity is. And it's interesting because I do see things through a gendered lens. I do see those qualities as feminine qualities, and yet that might also be my work to release that. You know, that it's something that I'm still on my journey of, like, is it a gendered quality or is it just being a good person? And we've only seen more male constructions of leadership because it tends to be men who hold more public positions or higher up on the CEO ranking system, and so that's all we understand. So that's sort of a more nuanced response. But my belief system is that in all types of leadership, I don't want us as women, as femmes, to have to perform a style of leadership or behavior in order to think that's how we can get a promotion. It's so unfair to us. We should be hiring people based on their authentic thoughts and ways of communicating, and we should foster work environments and spaces and design for spaces that allow people to feel psychologically safe to be themselves.
Yeah, yeah. There's a lot of work to be done there, I'll tell you.
I know. Every time I say that, people are like, you're delusional. But no, I guess we need the dreamers to know where we're going.
We absolutely do. We absolutely need to. I'm going to draw back to the idea of being linked and not ranked, because we live in the U.S. in this corporate hierarchical world. I'm in the world of higher ed, and it's also very hierarchical because there's someone always in charge and we all report up the line from one to the next. What does being linked and not ranked look like to you?
Being linked and not ranked is knowing that we benefit off of human connection, that being closed and guarded and fearful, it only holds us back. That actually at the core, we desire human connection. We desire giving to others and receiving, and that we should live in a world that people are valued based on their contribution and their desire to be in service of somebody else, rather than some kind of unearned privilege and ranking system that has the assumption that for one person to win, somebody else has to lose. I really fundamentally disagree with that. And yet so many of our power structures in this world are set up that way.
Yeah, well, I certainly love the idea. Okay, so you talk about the future being female, and maybe we've talked about this, so we can just touch on it. But because we're at the Women's Forum today, I do want to get your thought, because we say that a lot around here, that the future is female. What does that look like for you?
I think it is what we talked about. I think it's about valuing what women and femmes and feminine energy bring to the table, about valuing kindness and softness and sincerity and genuineness and authenticity, not feeling the need to perform some kind of power dynamic and assert that power over others. And, you know, for me, the future is female has always been about valuing what women bring to the table and what femininity brings to the table, so much so that even men feel a desire to step into that instead of saying, don't be such a girl, don't be so girly, don't be so soft. Instead, we affirm each other by saying, yeah, wow, I love how nuanced you are. I love how self-aware you are. I love how genuine you are. I love how caring you are. I love how thoughtful you are. You know, these kinds of things that are not reaffirmed in our society because maybe at one point in our history, they were seen as being weak. So that is really what that phrase means to me. It can be exclusive in so many different ways. And so I'm working on my own understanding of how to celebrate femininity, celebrate gender, celebrate, yeah, the rich diversity of the human experience, while still saying just because I show up for my body and my gender doesn't mean I won't show up just as hard for your body and your gender.
I love how you talk about people being nuanced. I always hear about situations being nuanced, but the idea that people are nuanced, it's not one or the other. It's just not one way. That's
right.
Very thoughtful. Okay, I'm going to quote something I read from you. Whether it's from our community, whether it's from ourselves, whether it's from our life, from a partner, all we want is love. That's why we're so addicted to social media. The dopamine effect of getting a like or a comment or a validation from someone whose opinion you really care about. So we have to remember that we need to value love when we see it, because it's the very thing we're trying to get. So that is really powerful. And it made me think of several different questions. But first, I'm just going to jump on the social media one. How is the social media relationship for you? Because as we know, actually, I think all of us can look at our feed and we see that someone you admire, someone you think is cool, likes you, and you're like, whoa, it's a kind of validation.
Totally.
It is, or whether
totally.
It is.
I don't think that's bad. I think it's both and. For social media, I definitely don't think there's anything wrong with us feeling validated and seen by community and by people we admire. In fact, making our heroes our friends is one of the most special things we can do in this life. I think it's just the fact that social is also reaffirming our own vanity and our own ego, and also creating a deficit such that we then are constantly addicted to feel that high. I tend to try to check myself and make sure that I'm only posting things that are a give, that are pieces of information or things that I think could benefit somebody else, and not only just things that might make me fill up my own emotional or insecure voids. So that's why I mentioned that, you know, and also sometimes we don't recognize love that's right next to us. And recognizing love in the real world is so important, because then we show up to social media already filled instead of needing something.
Yes. Oh, exquisite. Yeah. It's a lot of self-discovery, isn't it? So I want to close with just the thoughts on, tell me about, I know that you have another album you're working on, Vibrations, and then want to hear about what's next for Madame Gandhi.
Right now, it's actually been really wonderful for me to step into my own fitness, like to be snowboarding and surfing and doing yoga, meditation, running in the mountains. I live between downtown LA and Topanga Canyon, and spending time in nature and looking at the stars has honestly been so humbling, because I've been a city girl my whole life. And so the pandemic has allowed for that, because obviously we're in quarantine and we need to take space. So I've had my space be in nature, and that feels so good. And that then affirms my music. When I'm writing from a place of calmness, of enthusiasm, of freedom, of like free thinking. And it's really been such a joy to like take so much time and like give slow love to this album and like sing some lyrics and then listen back to the lyrics a month later and say, do these hold true? You know, and then I'll make small adjustments to make sure that they really feel authentic and timeless. So I am excited for this project. It takes a lot longer than I ever think it's going to, but I'm trusting the process.
It's wonderful. There have been those silver linings of this year where we've had to step back and step into nature and step into our creative selves. So I'm glad that you're finding your joy there and your creativity. It's been really wonderful being with you today. Thank you so much for spending this time with us, for all of us, all your fellow Hoyas. Most of us are females on the call, but we will be working alongside you. as you can continue to elevate the female voice and celebrating it. And I want to thank all our Hoyas here today. Thank you for tuning in to this special session of 1789 Seconds at the Women's Forum. I hope you'll join us next month for our next episode. Hoya Saxa.
Hoya Saxa, and please stay in touch on Madame Gandhi. Love.
Thank you.